Welcome back, students. In this section, I'll be talking to you about de novo synthesis of fatty acids. What does the name mean to you? It means synthesis of fatty acid from other sources. From a scratch, a new fatty acid is synthesized. What is it called as? Then it is also called as lignin spiral. That's a point to be remembered from the point of view of MCQs. When does this take place? It takes place whenever you are having excess calorie intake. So you have taken more of carbohydrates, you have taken more of fat, you have taken more of proteins, anything, everything. There's so much of calorie intake. That is when the body decides to store this extra calories as fat. And when it wants to store it as fat, it needs to synthesize the fatty acids, and it has to synthesize and store them in the adipose tissue. So what it does, that is what is happening here. So it takes place whenever there is excess caloric intake. So excess carbohydrates or proteins are converted to fatty acids and stored as triacylglycerol. So we go back to the adipose tissue. Till there we start from in this section. So de novo synthesis of fatty acids. What's happening out here is that, where is it happening? Where are the fatty acids synthesized? Which are the sites? Do you think it is happening in the adipose tissue? It does happen in the adipose tissue, but to a very less extent. Main sites are the liver. The liver is the main site. Other than the liver, we have the lactating mammary gland, because that is where milk production has to take place, and that is where fatty acids are present in milk, and it is naturally required. De novo synthesis has to take place. It also happens in adipose tissue, kidneys, and brain. Brain, because it has to form the very long chain fatty acid. VLCFA it has to form. Now, where is that happening? Within these cells, within these tissues, it is happening at the cytoplasm. Now, what does it require? Now, for the synthesis of fatty acid, we require acetyl-CoA and NADPH. NADPH provides the reducing equivalence. We have already learnt about carbohydrate metabolism. So from where did NADPH come? NADPH, please remember, does not provide energy. It is formed in the HMP shunt pathway. Glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase and 6-phosphogluconate dehydrogenase are the two important enzymes which produce NADPH. So, we have an absolute requirement of acetyl-CoA and NADPH to give the reducing equivalence. By the end of de novo synthesis, the fatty acid that is formed is palmitate. It is a 16 carbon compound. Now, elongation and desaturation further occurs to form other fatty acids. But by de novo synthesis, the fatty acid that is formed is palmitic acid. MCQ: stearic acid, oleic acid, linoleic acid? No, none of them. Only palmitic acid is formed by de novo synthesis. Others, are they formed? Yes, but the site is different, and the fatty acid synthesis complex is dissociated from the fatty acid synthesis complex, and it is happening. Some other enzymes are involved in it. So before we go ahead, let us look at the sources of acetyl-CoA and NADPH. So from where did acetyl-CoA come? As I said, whenever there is excess calorie. So excess calorie means there is more of carbohydrate, means more of glycolysis. So glucose is converted to pyruvate, pyruvate is converted to acetyl-CoA. So there is a huge amount of acetyl-CoA, and the body decides to store it. So one of the biggest sources of acetyl-CoA is pyruvate. And where is acetyl-CoA formed from pyruvate? It is formed in the mitochondria. Remember, pyruvate dehydrogenase complex is present in the mitochondria. And where is the synthesis taking place? Synthesis is taking place in the cytoplasm. So there must be some mechanism to transport out the acetyl-CoA. Now, as I said, acetyl-CoA can be produced from pyruvate. It can be got also from oxidation of fatty acids, though it will be a futile cycle if you oxidize fatty acid and then use that acetyl-CoA for the synthesis of fatty acid. So basically, this oxidation of fatty acid is very less, which contributes to the de novo synthesis. But degradation of proteins again is a very less contributor of acetyl-CoA. Mainly it comes from pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. What are the sources of NADPH? NADPH, hexose monophosphate shunt, HMP shunt. Remember that this is taking place in the cytosol, so no problem at all. And there is one more enzyme that is known as the malic enzyme, which converts malate to pyruvate. Now let us see how acetyl-CoA, which is produced in the mitochondria, is transported out into the cytosol, where de novo synthesis is taking place. So mainly the inner mitochondrial membrane permeable to acetyl-CoA? No, it is impermeable. So how does acetyl-CoA go out? Now, if this is the mitochondria, what will happen is acetyl-CoA will undergo the first reaction of TCA cycle. Remember, TCA cycle is happening in the mitochondria. So it will combine with oxaloacetate and form what is called as citrate. The first reaction of TCA cycle. This citrate can now cross across the membrane. The citrate crosses across the inner mitochondrial membrane. From the mitochondria, it goes into the cytosol. In the cytosol, it is acted upon by an enzyme ATP citrate lyase. ATP citrate lyase means what? It requires energy ATP and it breaks down citrate lyase into what? Into the components. Which are the components? Acetyl-CoA and oxaloacetate. Now, can oxaloacetate go back into the mitochondria? No, oxaloacetate also is impermeable. The inner mitochondrial membrane is impermeable to oxaloacetate. So, oxaloacetate is further converted into malate. And malate can enter into the mitochondria. The enzyme is again malate dehydrogenase. This goes back and it can be reconverted back into oxaloacetate. But the body has one more mechanism. One, it can use this malate can be converted to pyruvate and pyruvate can enter across the inner mitochondrial membrane into the cytosol, pyruvate. Now, why this is important is malate to pyruvate is catalyzed by the enzyme malic enzyme, and malic enzyme will result in the production of NADPH. So, what has happened? The body has found an efficient mechanism. One, it requires acetyl-CoA for the synthesis of de novo synthesis of fatty acid. It requires NADPH for the synthesis of fatty acid. Both these are produced by the simple act of transporting across the mitochondrial membrane. Pyruvate can then cross back. Pyruvate can be reconverted back into the different compounds that is happening within the mitochondrial matrix. So, I have written it out here. Acetyl-CoA is transported out as citrate. Oxaloacetate is converted to pyruvate, that is through the formation of malate, and then it is transported into the mitochondria. That is pyruvate, that is what is transported. Now, one NADPH is generated for each acetyl-CoA that is transferred from the mitochondria to the cytosol. So, both acetyl-CoA has come out and NADPH has also come out into the cytosol. So, that is the importance of this transport of acetyl-CoA. That's why I emphasized it. Now, what happens further to this acetyl-CoA? Now, that is what we will talk about in the cytosol. What is happening to this acetyl-CoA? Acetyl-CoA is acted upon by an important enzyme, acetyl-CoA carboxylase. Acetyl-CoA is converted into malonyl-CoA. This is something similar in reaction that is happening with propionic acid metabolism. Propionyl-CoA is converted to methylmalonyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA is converted to malonyl-CoA. So, which will be the enzyme? It will be a carboxylase. If it is a carboxylase, what does it require? It requires carbon dioxide, it requires biotin. Most importantly, all the carboxylases require biotin. So, in the presence of biotin, acetyl-CoA is converted into malonyl-CoA. Now, the enzyme is acetyl-CoA carboxylase. Acetyl-CoA carboxylase is the regulatory enzyme of de novo synthesis of fatty acids. So, it is the regulatory enzyme of de novo synthesis. Now, if you look at the 16 carbons of palmitate, 2 carbons are added in the form of acetyl-CoA at the omega end, and the rest 14 come from malonyl-CoA. Now, acetyl-CoA in the presence of ATP and biotin and carbon dioxide is converted into malonyl-CoA. Now, rest of the reactions, I'll just show you a schematic diagram. You need not know from an MCQ point of view that any of these pathways that are happening in the de novo synthesis. This is the enzyme acetyl-CoA carboxylase. Fatty acid synthesis proper, as I said, it is a, I'll talk in brief about fatty acid synthase complex. Now, why is this important? MCQ point of view. What is the synthase made up of? The steps proper may not be important, but the synthase, what is it? What is its action is important. Remember, fatty acid synthase is a multi-enzyme complex. That means it is a huge protein which has different catalytic domains, and each of these domains act as a separate enzyme by themselves. So, it is a multi-enzyme complex. It is a dimer. Remember, each fatty acid synthesis is a single polypeptide chain. But when it is in combination with two polypeptide chain, you call it a dimer. And each monomer is made up of a single polypeptide with seven enzyme activities. So again, we have a tertiary structure of protein which is forming domains responsible for different catalytic activities. So a single polypeptide is having seven enzyme activities and plus another protein called as acyl carrier protein, ACP. The ACP contains a group called as 4-phosphopantothene group, and that is what is important MCQ point of view. This provides the SH group, sulfhydryl group. A cysteine residue of one of the enzymes provides another sulfhydryl group. The sulfhydryl groups are very important for the synthesis of de novo synthesis of fatty acids, and the dimers are arranged in head to tail fashion. I have shown you a schematic diagram here. Remember, only the dimer is active, and the two SI chains are produced simultaneously. At a time, two palmitic acids are produced at a time. So both the dimer is active and both the chains are produced together. So if you look at it, this is how the dimer will look like, the fatty acid synthase complex. So this is one monomer having seven enzyme activities and one acyl carrier protein. This is the other monomer which is again having the seven enzyme activities and acyl carrier protein. Now these both are arranged in a head to tail fashion. Now if you look at it, this will be the subunits. But if you look like it, how does it function? It is only the dimer is active, so it functions in this manner. So it is, this is the functional division and this is the subunit division. I'll just give you the names of the seven enzymes, not required unless you need it for MCQs. But then also I would suggest they may not ask this because there is a lot of overlapping with other enzymes. So these are the seven enzymes. You can pause it and look at it. Now I'll just give you a brief overview how the fatty acid synthesis takes place. As I said, cysteine of one dimer and ACP of another dimer, the two sulfhydryl groups will be there. This is the fatty acid synthase. It gets acetyl-CoA gets added. So first is acetyl transacylase. So acetyl group is transferred. Once acetyl is transferred, what happens next? This acetyl group goes to the cysteine residue. It is called as acetyl S enzyme. Next, what happens is this combines with malonyl-CoA. It becomes, the enzyme is malonyl transacylase. Malonyl group is added here. Now what will happen is carbon dioxide is removed and beta-ketoacyl synthase is formed. Once that is formed, again we have so further actions happening. Now what is important here is NADPH, the reductive biosynthesis is converted to NADP, and this is the reductase. That's why I'm showing you this reactions. So it forms beta hydroxyacyl ACP, and this again loses one hydratase, loses water, and it forms transenoyl acyl ACP. And now again one more molecule of NADPH is acted upon and enol reductase, and it forms the acyl group, acyl ACP. Acyl ACP is these reactions, this is one cycle, are repeated six more times with the addition of malonyl CoA in each cycle. Now what happens? Finally, we have got one acyl compound which is 16 carbon long and which is this palmitate. Now comes the enzyme, the seventh enzyme thioesterase, which will use water, and palmitate is released. So that is how palmitic acid is synthesized within the body. Now we go on to the regulation, the most important thing. I always said it is the regulation which is important. Now there are two ways by which acetyl-CoA carboxylase is regulated. Remember, acetyl-CoA carboxylase is the regulatory enzyme. And also remember that malonyl-CoA inhibits what? Carnitine acyl transferase 1. So it basically inhibits beta oxidation. So now I talk about acetyl-CoA carboxylase. Now this is regulated in two mechanisms. One is by polymerization, slightly different, and the other is by covalent modification. Covalent modification, as I have already told to you, phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. Now polymerization is done with the help of citrate. From where did citrate come? Citrate is an indicator of the energy status. It comes from TCA cycle. So the citrate, what does it do? It polymerizes acetyl-CoA carboxylase and this becomes active. So polymerization is done by citrate and acetyl-CoA carboxylase is active in the dephosphorylated form. When did I say what causes dephosphorylation? Insulin causes dephosphorylation. And when is insulin high? In the well-fed state. So in the well-fed state, should fatty acid be synthesized? Yes. Only then fatty acids can be store that well-fed energy as triacylglycerol. So insulin, what does it do? It causes dephosphorylation. So acetyl-CoA carboxylase is active in the dephosphorylated form. What happens to this palmitic acid? This palmitic acid can undergo elongation. Why? Wherever it is required. So we have a microsomal elongation system which is happening in the endoplasmic reticulum, and the donor of carbon atoms is malonyl-CoA. It is also called as fatty acid elongase, and the reactions are similar to fatty acid synthesis except that it is occurring in the endoplasmic reticulum, and the main product is stearyl-CoA. Very long chain fatty acid C22, C24 are also produced, especially in the brain, by the microsomal elongation system. We also have a mitochondrial elongation system which is very less active, and the donor of two carbon atoms is acetyl-CoA. What happens? What about the unsaturated fatty acid? Are they happening? Yes, desaturation of fatty acids also happen in the body by the microsomal system, requires molecular oxygen and cytochrome P5. The enzyme is a desaturase. Palmitic acid forms palmitolic 16:1 delta 9, means in the ninth position is the double bond. Stearic acid forms oleic acid, which is 18 carbon and one double bond in the delta 9 position. Please note here, mammals lack the enzyme to introduce double bonds beyond the delta 9 position. So what? It will mean that certain polyunsaturated fatty acids which have double bond beyond the delta 9 are essential for us because we do not have the enzymes. So which are the essential fatty acids? And so humans cannot synthesize linoleic acid. Why? It is having delta 9 and 12. The double bond is at the 12th position. And linolenic acid, which is having delta 9, 12 and 15. So 12 and 15 cannot be introduced. We cannot introduce a double bond at the 12th position or at the 15th position. But there is one more important essential fatty acid which is told in the literature, and that is arachidonic acid. Actually, arachidonic acid is also essential, but sometimes in the body it can be synthesized by linolenic acid by elongation followed by desaturation. So linolenic acid can be converted to arachidonic acid. Remember, this is 18, can be elongated to 20. Minute it gets elongated to 20, the double bond positions will change, and then it can introduce 9 will become 8, 11, 12 will become 11, 15 will become 14. So all it has to do is introduce a double bond in the 5th position, and that is possible, and hence arachidonic acid with delta 5, 8, 11, 14, it is possible to synthesize from linolenic acid. However, it is still considered, the amount that is formed may not be sufficient, and arachidonic acid is still considered as essential. Now we go ahead with lipogenesis. What happens to this fatty acid that is synthesized? So we go on to the synthesis of triacylglycerol. As I said, TAG is the neutral fat and it is a storage form of fatty acid. So where is it stored? It is stored naturally in the adipose tissue, but TAG synthesis also takes place in the liver. The liver does not store TAG, but it transports whatever TAG is formed, it is transports it out from the liver. I'll tell you about it in lipoprotein metabolism. So the major sites are adipose tissue and liver. Subcellular site is the cytosol. So glycerol is required for this, and glycerol should be in the form of glycerol 3-phosphate, and glycerol kinase is absent in the adipose tissue, and in adipose tissue glycerol 3-phosphate is synthesized via dihydroxyacetone phosphate, and DHAP is the intermediate of glycolysis. I'll just show you a schematic diagram. Glycerol has to be phosphorylated, and this is done by glycerol kinase, which is absent in adipose tissue, whereas it can come from dihydroxyacetone phosphate by the enzyme glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. What happens to it? Once glycerol 3-phosphate is formed, then glycerol 3-phosphate acyl transferase will transfer one molecule of acyl CoA and goes on from lysophosphatidic acid. Lysophosphatidic acid, one more molecule of fatty acid will form phosphatidic acid. Remember, it is still having phosphate here, and so it is not triacylglycerol. Now comes the portion of removing this phosphate group, and phosphatidic acid, water is added, inorganic phosphate is removed, and glycerol with its two fatty acids becomes 1,2-diacylglycerol, and this again acts with one more acyl CoA, acyl transferase, and triacylglycerol is formed. So triacylglycerol is whatever is formed will have different fate in the liver or in the adipose tissue. In the liver, it is transported out of the liver via the formation of VLDL. So whatever TAG is formed is called as the endogenous triacylglycerol, and this is transported to the extrahepatic tissues. We'll talk about VLDL metabolism in detail later. TAG stored in the cytosol is in the form of lipid droplets, and adipose tissue is in a dynamic state. Some amount of lipolysis and lipogenesis are continuously occurring. So with this, we come to the end of de novo synthesis of fatty acid followed by triacylglycerol formation and what happens to it in the adipose tissue and in the liver. Please remember that TAG is synthesized both in the liver and in the adipose tissue. In the liver, it is transported out in the form of VLDL. In the adipose tissue, it remains as TAG in the cytosol as lipid droplets. In the next class, we'll talk about phospholipid metabolism. Thank you.